right, I made a mistake today, and which is very instructive. We're all going to make mistakes, and it's a matter of correcting, catching the mistake, correcting the mistake. And the mistake I made was, I had this in the, this morning. I had this realization that I'm through with dreaming. What I did was I tried to figure out, okay, how did I manage to get to this place, and then how does this fit in with some, you know, teaching like A Course in Miracles? How does that fit in with that? Can I get some help? Let me read something. All these things are mistakes, because the spiritual path is a path of practice. And our practice is three parts. It's assertions, full stop, and the wow, flipping the script. Flipping the script is the theorizing, the thinking, the theorizing, looking at it. But that has to be in the context of the rest of the practice. You cannot just forget about assertions and full stop and the wow and just be studying, you know, how can I fit this in? Stopping dreaming, what does that mean? How am I going to feel? You know, can I get some insight reading this book? There's a mistake. What we're supposed to do is when a realization dawns within us, we're supposed to accept it as a fait accompli and then say, okay, yes, I am going to stop dreaming. Yes, I have stopped dreaming. And rehearse actually doing that, actually experiencing it, actually just rehearsing, yes, I have stopped dreaming. I'm finished with dreams, and accept it. So what we do is we work on acceptance. This is the real way to go about it. We should not divorce anything we do from this basic practice. So whatever we're reading, it should be in the context of this practice. And so I made the mistake of getting outside of that and got ended up with some depression and upset and stuff. And then I caught myself saying, hey, wait a minute, that's not right. Because we can get very depressed when... I had to suppress the sneeze, but did so. When we get very depressed, when our spiritual experiencing doesn't, we can't align it with some spiritual teaching that some teachers give us. We can't align it properly. Now, the great thing about this practice that we have here is there is no dogmatic specific teaching except for the structure of the practice itself. So whatever it is that you're experiencing spiritually, just put it into the context of this practice. Wow, this is really heavy. This is, wow. For instance, wow, I decided I'm going to stop dreaming. Wow, full stop in the wow. Get used to this. Accept, assert. Yes, I have stopped dreaming. Yes, I have stopped dreaming. I've stopped dreaming. Yes, I have stopped dreaming. Keep trying to trigger that wow over and over. But you can you use this for whatever insight arises, whatever breakthrough you have, whatever, however spirit presents it to you. And everyone is unique. So it's impossible to write a book of dogmatic teachings that lay out a path for everybody. Every path is going to be unique. So it's better to lay out a discipline of practice in where you can practice this no matter what arises. Okay? This is the key. This is really the key. And the better you get at this practice, automatically the breakthroughs will arise. Automatically. Automatically. Because you can handle them. We're able to absorb the shock. Oh, I'm going to stop dreaming. What a shock. But I have the tools to accept this, you see, and allow the shock to wear off. Allow the wow shock to wear off. If we don't have these tools, we'll just say, oh my, what does that mean? I don't understand what this means. I better go read, 100 pages of this book and 100 pages of this book. And before you know it, your mind is just full of thoughts and you're all confused and depressed. I don't understand. How come I'm not in sync with these teachers? I must be failing. It's like that. It's terrible. So you just have to lean on the practice itself. This is what is so helpful. I don't care what anyone said or not said. I just know that how to stay in the wow, stay neutral there, and then keep asserting, yes, I'm finished with dreaming. Yes, I am. That no, there's no more dreaming for me. Yes, I know there's no more dreaming for me. I accept that there's no more dreaming for me. Keep asserting and keep feeling the wow of the statement. And then you can do some flipping of the script and whatever occurs to you. So it's sort of like a self-guided spiritual path where the vehicle is the practice itself. Wherever you go, you have the steering wheel, the accelerator, and the brake. Whatever road you're on, you have those three. So you can drive your car. And the varieties of everybody's, you know, conceptual structures and defenses, everything, you cannot lay out some universal curriculum and say, this is what you're going to experience, or this is the sequence, or something like that. You cannot do that. It's so varied. So, but this works with any insight that one has. Whatever insight one has, this practice works with it. It's kind of like the wheel, you know, whatever, you know, you put wheels on, it's going to roll. So your spiritual path, the insights, experiences you have will be unique to you. Don't worry about trying to cross-reference it with somebody else. Just keep this discipline going. How can a book cover all possible insights and all that? It cannot. The book would go on forever and nobody could read it. So it's not really possible at all. So for me, the religious spiritual path is a path of practice discipline. This is what people need to be schooled in. Children need to be schooled in this. Everyone in society needs to be schooled. This is the way we practice. And then each one will then be able to guide, have their own path emerge for them, their own undoing. Jesus says salvation is not a doing, it's an undoing. But how this undoing takes place is quite unique for everybody. But everybody will be able to allow this undoing to take place. And they won't worry about what someone else is doing. You know, they have their hands full with their own path. So, you know, where did that decision come from? I don't try to figure it out. It's because it's really this is the sum total of everything I've done and the grace of God and all that mixed together. And, you know, it just I sort of felt like that's it. I'm really finished. I've really had it. I don't want any more dreaming. I don't need any more dream outcomes or modification. I don't need it anymore. I don't want it anymore. And so this is where I'm at right now. And can't explain. Why explain? How did I get here? That's like an impossible explanation. Why waste time on that? That doesn't help at all. This is where I'm at right now, and I have to work on accepting it. That's the key part. Accept where you're at in terms of the latest breakthrough you've had. And let's say maybe you haven't had so many breakthroughs, but you're still practicing. Well, where are you at? You're reinforcing the right practice, and that's a huge wow right there. Huge. Super important. Without this right practice, how can you go forward? So there's always a way to look at your life in a wow, glasses half full way. Always. I'm not as bad off as I was yesterday. I'm not as deluded as I was yesterday. Wow, that's great. That's huge. So always we can go big. Glass half full, going big. Wow, every single day. Go big every day. And it may be something different every day. For me, it's something different every day. Previously, it was, this is I am now. This is I am now. This is I am now. This is it. This is I am now. That seemed to have a very profound effect, a very helpful effect. And after that was my mind, after waking up from napping, my mind was all busy with the dreaming while I was napping, humming and thinking. And suddenly just went quiet, just still, completely still. Just stopped. So that's where I was at. And then this morning, I said, I'm not interested in dreaming anymore. I'm finished with it. Okay, well, that's where I'm at. So it's how we manage the success of each of these, you know, each breakthrough we have. That's what's important. Don't look forward or back or explain or take measure at all. Just say, this is where I'm at. I am going to accept that this is where I'm at, and I am trying to accept it. Say, okay, you know, this is me now. This is what I am right now. Right here, right now, this is what I am. Now, far from getting stuck, in doing that, we open the door up for further breakthroughs because we've shown we're able to handle breakthroughs. You see, we really want to undo all, you know, to set down. We really want to let go of this dream of death. And so when we're able to, you know, handle, you know, a little bit like that, it will happen for us automatically. So I'm sort of saying, in some ways, enlightenment is like automatic, but it depends. See, people say, is sudden enlightenment or gradual? It's both. It's both. It's automatically takes place when you have practiced the full stop and the wow, and this practicing, when you're good enough at this practice to handle the shock, then it arises. So it's both. It's not a paradox. It's just that. Let's say, you wanted to sink down into the stillness of the ocean, perfectly calm, perfectly still, symbolizes as the ocean. And we're on the surface and we're bobbing around, that all the chop, you know, is causing us to be all moving around like this, choppy waves and everything. It's like, wow, I just wish I could get beneath the surface here and where we'd be all still and quiet, you know, it'd be great. But let's say, like, we have this life vest on, this pumped up with air, and it's keeping us floating. We keep floating on the surface. We don't want the surface. So we let out a little air, and we sink down a little bit, all right? But we say, whoa, I'm starting to sink down, wow. And then we kind of get used to that. I'm not as buoyant as before. And then let a little more air out, and you sink down some more. And you say, great. But then you're still kind of nervous. Oh, what's going to be like under the surface? And get used to that, and then you let a little more air out. Automatically, then, you sink down a little more. So you're not going to sink unless you let air out, but once you let air out, you automatically sink. And then you let enough air out, you automatically sink beneath the surface. And then you let a little more out, you sink a little deeper, a little more. And finally, you let all the air out, and you come to rest in the depths of the ocean, and you won't go up or down anymore at all. You've reached this perfect equilibrium. There's no more air to cause to let lodge go down, and you won't go up. You've reached this perfect equilibrium. And that's it. That's it. So the more we practice, the more we sink into the towards the equilibrium, the peace, the stillness, it automatically arises, you know, like that. So we don't have to worry about the destination. That will, we will gradually, and then at some point we may reach that equilibrium. And now, reaching that point of equilibrium, that is a bigger wow, isn't it? Because we're used to still letting air out and sinking, letting air out, sinking, letting out, sinking. But then what if you go to the valve to open it up and let air out and nothing more is there? And then you realize, hey, I'm not going to sink or move and nothing more is going to happen. I've got this perfect equilibrium. Then that's a, you know, that's a huge wow. And you could say that's the sudden enlightenment that you realize, wow, I'm this is it. So we don't have to try and force anything. It will happen on its own. We just have to keep letting the air out of the air of arrogance. You know, keep letting the arrogance out. We have this vest that's pumped up with arrogance that's keeping us on this very choppy surface of the water where we're just getting buffeted around. And it's terrible. We say, oh, I just want peace of mind. My mind is constantly in turmoil. Choppy like choppy waves. Chop this way, chop that way. Wind blows and the chop, you know, gets stronger and spray, and it's just horrible. And we knew if we just got beneath the surface, all of that would be gone, and we'd just be in peace. Now, what are dreams? They're an attempt to modify the ocean, so to speak. To modify it. But all modification is merely on the surface, which is only relative to other surface areas. It doesn't modify the depths of the ocean at all. So letting go of dreams means you're sinking beneath the surface of the ocean. You're no longer paying attention to all that chop. It's meaningless. Now, it's very important to not to try and relate this to any particular teaching or context. Just stay in the wow of it. That's all. We don't have to label what we're doing a particular religion or teaching. This is just a standard basic practice. This is the structure of what really spiritual practice is all about. And so you don't have to worry like, well, what does this mean? How do I, you know, fit it into some teacher's teaching or some tradition or anything like that? No, don't even think about that. Because ultimately, what we're highlighting is the practice itself, not any, you know, particular teaching in particular. Rather, what is the successful way to practice? This is what's important. So we don't need to worry. Well, is this what a teacher said it would be like, or how does this fit? No, don't measure it. Don't assess it. Just allow it. Accept it. Get used to it. Allow, accept, get used to it. from I can do this to I will do this to I have done it. I've done it. I've done it. That's it. Just I've done it. This, that's all. And so you're not out on a limb all alone. You have the practice. Take refuge in the practice. You have the practice. We have this practice. Everyone can do this practice. Doesn't matter what their background or their traditions are or anything like that. It's all, the practice isn't about managing your success. However that success appears or symbolizes to anyone, it has to be managed. Got this great cricket, I guess I call it a cricket, making that chirping sound. Just want to be nice if there are some others. But this one's very nice in its own right. So what's most important to have? The right practice is the most important. So when you have what's most important, you're not all nervous about, you know, anything else really. You say, well, I know how to handle breakthroughs, and so I'll just do that. So I know how to drive a car. Once you know how to drive a car, well, that's more important than any particular car you're driving. You can drive any car. Once you know how to drive a car, you can drive any vehicle. So this is, you know, this practice, full stop in the wow. We, you know, again, anyone can do this from any background. Can be atheistic if you want. You don't have to attach particular labels to various experiences. Now keep in mind that this practice is not like you're trying to just sit quietly and hear the stillness of the night or something like that. No. This is more along the lines of you'll have breakthroughs, especially when you go to sleep and when you wake up in the morning and sometimes during the daytime, you'll have a sudden insight. You just suddenly realize, wow, it's the, where does this come from? The Holy Spirit puts us there, puts it there in our mind. We have to trust the Holy Spirit. This is essential. We don't have to generate these insights for ourselves. The Holy Spirit has them there waiting for us. He's just waiting for us to be able to handle them properly. It's like treats for a dog. You give a dog a treat and it, you know, it chomp, 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 chomp. Swallow, give another treat, chomp, chomp, chomp. And as long as the dog is chomping and swallowing, you keep giving the dog treats. And, you know, it's like that. But if the dog gets sidetracked and, oh, turns around, starts biting, you know, for fleas, starts biting, scratching for fleas, smelling something else, you know, you can't give the treats when the dog's like all distracted like that. Then the dog comes back and then here's a treat and chomp, 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 swallow. So the Holy Spirit has all these like treats for us, and we have to be very, you know, chomp, 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 chomp. Chew up the treat and then swallow the treat and clear the palate and get ready for another one. Clean the palate. Now, we always feel like, well, I should be able to go faster, but in my experience, the Holy Spirit has always brought forth something important. You know, it's tough. You want to go faster. It's out of your hands. It seems like it's out of your hands. But, you know, the Holy Spirit knows what we can handle, what we can't. So, we're getting as much as we can handle. And I've always complained, well, how come I'm not having these experiences other people have, etc.? Everyone's path is unique. You cannot compare and judge paths successfully. You cannot know the sequence. Everyone has a different sequence of how they'll go about it. So you can't really know where you're at. Because if you try to figure out where am I at, well, you think you start comparing your path with someone else's path, or think maybe that you'll be able to judge where you're at, and then you get really confused. We don't really know what the next breakthrough is going to be. We've been blind to it. Everyone seems like it's like, wow, I saw something I was blind to before, and didn't see that at all. This is what it's like. So right now I'm saying, well, I don't know what's next because I have a blind spot. I'm not able to see it. But what I can do is keep myself calm, composed, full stop in the wow. Keep making assertions, keep flipping the script, and I can just keep practicing. I can do that. I have control over that. But I don't really know what the next insight will be. It can come at any time, just driving along, whatever, suddenly it pop into your mind like, hey, now I see this. It's just, I've never seen this before. Wow. So I can assert, yes, I'm without dreams. Now, I'm without dreams. I don't have any dreams. I'm without dreams. And I just felt this sort of shiver throughout me, like I was accepting this. It's like, wow. You know, this is a radical, you know, departure. This is a huge difference. My whole life I've been dreaming constantly, and now I'm going to be without dreams. I accept that. No more dreams. I'm finished. So this practice is, we want to feel, believe and feel as if we've already done it. It's called the already practice. This is very important for the potency to really settle in. We're not begging, we're not hoping, we're asserting and believing and rehearsing that I've already done it. I've already agreed, I'm without dreams. This is how I'm going to be now. Anytime you can get into this already done it and really believe it, you will feel a wow. There's no question about it. I don't know what everybody's doing all the time. I only know what I'm doing. You know, you see people in public, well, they're going about their business, but maybe when they're home, they're practicing. I doubt it. I think a lot of people are spending time on social media, texting, talking on the phone, Facebooking, viewing, videos, movies, somehow keeping themselves constantly in this dream condition of their mind, think, modify, 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 modify. I had these videos before. I talked about take refuge in. Can't remember exactly what it was, but I said like an ocean that's like a black pigment, that no matter what you pour into that ocean, the pigment remains black. The more you keep pouring different colors in, the more black it gets. I mean, it, or at least it doesn't change at all. Like that non-dual abidance, take refuge in non-dual abidance where nothing is changing. Well, this would be the end of dreaming, right? No matter, in other words, just that no matter what's happening, your mind remains completely still and like empty. No dream thoughts arise. All our thinking is really like kind of a dreaming, isn't it? We're reacting to what seems to be happening. We're reacting to it, and our thoughts are going this way and that way. We're imagining this. It's all a dream state. It's a dream state. It's an imagining state. But with no more dreaming, it means the mind is just crystal clear and calm. And whatever happens, nothing, no dreaming arises. Just like you sink down in the ocean, no matter how much the wind blows, it doesn't affect you at all. Just a surface chop, but you're beneath the surface, and there's no chop, or spray or anything in your mind at all. It still remains perfectly quiet and still. No more dreaming. Now, we don't realize during the daytime that we're constantly dreaming too. Just when we go to sleep, then the dreaming becomes more obvious and becomes seems to be much more creative and embellished. But really, during the daytime too, we're dreaming, constantly thinking and imagining and judging and evaluating and measuring and wondering and modifying and hoping, and all these constellation of thoughts are continuously going on. We just think it's normal. But when our minds go quiet, we suddenly realize, oh my gosh, there was just all this massive amount of like a beehive humming of thoughts. Suddenly that whole beehive just went quiet. That's when you realize just how busy your mind really is all the time. It's constantly busy. Thinking, 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 which is really dreaming. So, always try to take a big step. Go big, and whatever it is for you. Just say, okay, I'm going to accept it, that this is something, not only do I want to do this, I will do it, and I have done it. So get first step is to say, I believe I can do this. I believe I can do this. and then work with assertions and flipping the script and this practice, work to get it to go, I will do it. So it's in your will now, not I can, it's like it's a possibility, but now say, no, I will do this. Get used to that, and then go saying, I've done it. Therefore, we don't have to think about can and will anymore, right? Once we've done something, we don't have to think about can and will. We've done it. I've already done it. So we have this three-part practice and also three intensities to it. Can, will, and already have done it. This abiding in the no dreaming state, no more dreams, empty mind, so to say, dream mind emptied of dreams. This is very helpful for people to realize that they can experience this when the world is becoming extreme, gone into a drastic situation. So anyone who has this, you know, empty mind, calm mind, peaceful mind like this, no matter what happens, this can be very helpful for many people who are feeling tortured by the world right now. The world is really a torturer. Of course, the world is just a projection. We're torturing ourselves, but we, just for the sake of talking, we'll say the world is a torturer. It's constantly torturing us. And people feel like they're in the hands of a demented torturer. They can't escape, like they're in a torture chamber, and they're being just, all these different tortures are being applied to them. And then to come across someone who is not being tortured, you know, they just, it's like, wow, that's great. You know, I don't want to try to fit it into some other context. I just feel pragmatically this sort of empty mind, it's hard to say what it is. It's a mind that is not moved, a mind that is not moved into dreaming at all, free of all dreaming. The dream-free mind is a super pragmatically helpful situation in this world right now, as the world goes towards all sorts of troubles, and there's a severe bar fight going on. I'm not watching the news any 3 days now. I don't know what's going on. I do have reason to be suspicious about an asteroid. There's no question. In a dream last night, I remote viewed an asteroid, and the Holy Spirit seems to have tipped off that you know, there's some indications that something will hit the ocean. Some, you know, space rock will hit the ocean. I don't know how bad. Maybe we can make it not so bad. But I have my suspicions that this is. It would not be a surprise if it happens at all, and this would, you know, this would really add to the witch's brew of severe, drastic, feeling of drasticness. People can't sleep. Their minds are tossing and turning, you know. The wave, the surface is super choppy. Big waves all over the place, very choppy. Of course, an asteroid hitting the ocean would produce massive worldwide chop in the ocean. There's no question about it. Very symbolic, isn't it? It's like throwing a huge stone in a still pond. What happens? There's a lot of chop for a long time, right? And so you're looking at what was a still pond, and it's now just chaotically choppy. And you say, oh my gosh, and then what if you came across somebody whose mind was just like a still pond, absolutely still pond. And you got this feeling like, huh, it's possible. And then you have some hope, enter the situation. And you rally your will a little bit. So maybe I don't have to pay so much attention to the chop. Maybe I can get beneath the surface. So that's what's really important. In terms of the world, for me, it's living here in the world. It's the intensity of you know, the winds that are blowing in the world right now. They're blowing in so many different directions. You have a very, very stormy ocean, which means a superficial mind is very, very stormy right now. Crisis-wise stormy. And it's liable to get much, much worse. In many ways, you can look at the future and recognize, wow, this is really big trouble that's coming. So, being here, my only thought is, how can I be helpful? How can I be helpful? How can I be part of the solution, not part of the problem? So, quiet mind, peaceful mind, still mind, untroubled mind, seamless mind. Effortless mind, you know, that, all of that will help people calm their minds down. And this is what is going to be needed going forward. It's needed right now, as a matter of fact. But people are still medicating. They're trying to think, well, no, I can handle it somehow. Although not all of them are. But with the way the world is trending, you know, it could be that a lot of, you know, many, many people say, wow, this is just too much. This is a crisis. What people will really be looking for is does someone have a mind that's untroubled, a truly untroubled mind? This is what they're looking for. They're not, at some point, hugs aren't going to, affectionate hugs aren't going to do it. Do the job. A lot of people are forming survival relationships right now, dependency relationships. They know, they can feel what's coming, and they say, okay, I just, you know, that's really a lot of what was behind gay marriage is the, you know, gays, they want to feel like they have a committed partner. They can be in, you know, get in a marriage, and they feel that they'll be more secure that way. So I understand that. That's fine. If that's what they want to do. If you put it in the context of the times, you know, now, does that work? No, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. Clinging to some special relationship is not what works. But it's like everybody's like desperate right now. I need to feel like I can, you know, be committed, and somebody's going to be there for me, and there's someone I can cling to, and I've got to, you know, they're not going to leave me, and let me try and see if this is, if I can sanctify this and make it right, and they're hoping that will work, and it won't work. It won't work because your partner has their mind is all choppy and stormy too. And then they try to say, well, let's make choppy and stormy fun. Let's have sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And let's celebrate the stormy choppiness. And let's embrace it. How does that work? Doesn't work. Get pulled down more and more and more. Many have gone down that pathway. Many, many, many. And there's not a single one that can tell you that really worked at all. In fact, it made things terrible. So, ultimately, the thing to do is find, you know, untroubled mind, the mind that is Is it possible for mind to be, you know, untroubled, totally untroubled? Now, idols don't work either. You know, if you hold up an idol of someone, even a picture of a saint, it's not enough. I don't believe it's enough, because you say, well, they're not here right now. But having someone's here right now, then people will see, oh, the mind is not moving. It's still untroubled. There's nothing causing any chop at all in this mind. How is that possible? And yet they see it and they say, well, I know it's possible because I'm experiencing it. I'm seeing it. I recognize it. I can feel it. So it's got to be possible, right here, right now. Now, it's interesting, a couple of days ago, it was Wednesday, several days ago, I had this situation where I became frantic and felt like becoming super activist, so I let myself experience this. I said, okay, this is how it's going to be in the world for those who decide to go towards activism. This is how it's going to be. Super intense. Just you know, wow. Ride the roller coaster, doing a handstand or something. And then I realized, okay, that's not for me, but at least I know how it feels. I know where they're at. And then I wanted to see, can you back away from this? And I found out, yes, you can. Yes, you can. And you back in towards, you know, peaceful mind. I had these experiences yesterday, Friday, of my mind suddenly going quiet. Just suddenly going quiet. So, we can. I know we can back away from even the most intense activism. Furious fighting, ideological fighting, furious. My mind was in a state of ready to take on the world. I was ready to take it all on. Just me. I'm going to take it all on and give it everything I got. And feel the intensity was extreme. And then I was able to back away from it. So we can back away from it. We don't have to go nuclear. We can back away from it. We absolutely can back away from it. Even when the world is like feeling like, well, the whole thing's ready to go nuclear, the whole world, you know, is getting closer and closer to that feeling, we can back away from that and be, you know, completely untroubled. Now, there are those who have done that before. I study their lives, but we got to do it now. You know, the threat that I've lived with my whole life is the world going nuclear. Now, a lot of these spiritual teachers did not live with that threat, actually. It was very different. The level of threat now is way greater. I mean, their threat was maybe there's going to be a war, maybe some tribal skirmishes. Maybe there's an epidemic, you know, famine, things like that. Okay, yeah, those are severe things. But the threat of the world going nuclear is a whole different level of threat and concern. I mean, I grew up during the Cold War, so I'm a Cold War baby. That's pretty much how I identify myself, really. I'm not really a boomer. Right on the tail end of the boomers, but really, I grew up with the threat of the Cold War and nuclear annihilation. Nice, tranquil childhood, you know. Like, we don't have a bomb shelter. We're gonna all just like be fried. How come we don't have a bomb shelter? What can we do? When we get the warning, you know, the air raid warnings is. You know, nuclear bombers or Russian bombers with nuclear bombs are going to be dropped on us. What do we do? Nothing. We know where to hide. So I always would fantasize. You know, how can I get somewhere? And maybe there's some tunnel or some cave I can get to or something like that. You know, growing up with this constant fear in the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1963, I was 7 years old. And, you know, we barely averted nuclear war. And the feeling was that it could happen any time. So this was a horrible, I mean, this is probably the worst upbringing, you know, worst time to ever be born in this world. Is right there during the Cold War, where you had two nuclear superpowers who wanted to annihilate each other, and they were crazy enough to actually do it, almost crazy enough to do it. There's never been that kind of level of threat, you know, existential threat. Not just you, the feeling, just everything, the whole world is going to be destroyed, and loss of your life, not just loss of your life, loss of your home, loss of everything, everybody, your parents, your family members, friends, everybody's going to be annihilated. Could be today, could be tonight while you're sleeping. Maybe I listen to the transistor radio, listening to the Giants games, really partially to make sure if there was a bombing happening, I would be alerted. I'd be listening to the radio at night, you know. That's maybe a very strong underlying reason why I always had the, at night I had the transistor radio under my pillow listening to the Giants game. But, you know, of course, if there was an attack, it would be the game would be interrupted, go to emergency radio broadcast and say, you know, alert, 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 head to your nearest bomb shelter. Well, you know, we didn't have a near bomb shelter here. That was a culture growing up. Was people were, we didn't talk about it too much, but underneath the surface, you know, we were petrified. So this is unique. This is unique, being a Cold War baby. It puts this incredible pressure. Now, gradually the Cold War, you know, dissipated. And the people born in that era, you know, it wasn't all about, you know, fallout shelters and air raid drills and how can we survive a nuclear holocaust so much? It was, you know, so they grew up in a much more relaxed atmosphere. Well, sure, you know, we have skirmishes here and there, you know, we're worried about North Korea and a little bit and here and there, but there was nothing compared to what we went through, where we had these huge towers on the mountains built in radar, you know, early warning systems. There's one right up near here, and it's early warning system for Russian bombers with nuclear weapons. This is what we expected would happen. Not just regular bombs, nuclear bombs. You know, end of the world. So I grew up with this feeling that, you know, the end of the world could happen any moment. Horrible childhood. Probably, like I said, maybe the worst time to be born ever is right in the middle of that, when the Cold War really became ferociously dangerous. And you couldn't drive. You depend on your parents. You know, it's horrible. I mean, if you're an adult at that time, you could say, well, maybe we'll move to Canada, or we'll move inland, or, you know, go somewhere. But if you're just a kid, you know, you're stuck where your parents are. I often thought of running away from home and going somewhere else. I wanted to escape the West Coast because it was too frightening living here. Because this is where they would have dropped the bombs. They would have definitely dropped the bombs on San Francisco, Silicon Valley, Seattle, L.A., those areas. West Coast cities. So, yeah, it was horrible. So really, for me, it's always been the question, how do you have peace of mind when a nuclear bomb is being dropped on you? That's really, you know, come on. I look at the gurus and say, give me the answer. That's the question. Keep in mind that the nuclear bomb also is a dream. All of this is a dream. And now You know, we're afraid of something that's similar to a nuclear bomb, which would be an asteroid. A lot of people are worried about this. It would certainly, you know, I've had dreams that basically I realized that you know, an asteroid must have hit the world because it's the aftermath of it. And what happens is if it hits the ocean, if it's big enough, it sends up an enormous amount of superheated steam, moisture. The energy of an asteroid, if its size is big enough, coming in through the atmosphere and then hitting the ocean, it transmits so much energy to the ocean, it's just hard to calculate. And that energy, you know, rapid transmission of that energy, just would just absolutely turn massive amounts of the ocean into steam, superheated steam, that just goes up way, 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 way up in the atmosphere. It rises so fast, being so hot. Hot air rises. You know, the air, the steam. So you would have this in high atmosphere, would become super saturated with moisture. The entire planet, it would spread over the whole planet, and the whole planet would have this. And it may end up with dense cloud cover as it precipitates eventually, blotting out the sun. And you'd have this persistent drizzle. Rain and drizzle over the whole planet. It'd be dark, it'd be cold, it'd be drizzly, rainy, drizzly. And of course, then there'd also be likely a lot of dust. If it goes to the bottom of the ocean and to the mantle of the Earth, there'd be a lot of superheated dust also that would go up in the atmosphere, and that would come down with the rain too. And things would be, you know, it would be dusty and damp and cold and dark, and crops would fail and all this kind of stuff. So, you know, it's a kind of like a nuclear winter of sorts from an asteroid. So just when we think we have nuclear weapons under control, you know, here comes the fear of an asteroid. Gee, great bookends to life, huh? Born during the Cold War, end life with an asteroid strike, and in between, terrified of both. Great life. Thanks, world. Thanks a lot. Thanks a million. So at least we're cognizant, you know, of what the potential parameters are in this world, and so what can we do with the mind to remain completely untroubled by all of this, undisturbed by it? Now, I'm convinced there must be some answer. And for me, I feel I'm more of a pragmatist. I know the history of this planet. I've studied it so much that there's no question that the world has had drastic extinction level events happen. You know, quite a few of them, and some minor ones, and just enormous change on this planet. There could have been several pole shifts take place, axle tilts. You know, that could very well have happened. There have been just incredible disasters on this planet. That's part of the dreaming of this planet. There's no question about it. So it's just not a matter of saying, well, let's just have good dreams for a while. You know, the potential is always there to have those dreams modified. That's the problem with dreaming. It can always be modified. You dream a peaceful dream, it can still be modified. Is better no dreaming at all. Or you might say the dream of no dream. The condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. This is the ocean thing. Okay, abide in the condition-free condition. This is what I would say is safety, is refuge. Abide in the condition-free condition. So a nuclear bomb explodes, you're in the condition-free condition. That doesn't touch your mind at all. because a nuclear explosion is a condition. An asteroid hits, it doesn't affect you in the slightest bit. You're in the condition-free condition. The dream of no dream. The final dream is the dream of no dream. The final condition is the condition-free condition. It's funny, we may have left Hawaii when I was like ages 2 through 4 or something like that, 2, 3. We stayed in Hawaii most of the year, and then we came to the mainland for the summers. And we decided to leave Hawaii, and I always was bitterly opposed to that. And we moved to the West Coast permanently. Started out on the West Coast, then we moved to Hawaii for a while and came back, and. You know, it may have very well been that my parents were afraid that that Hawaii may have gotten bombed by the Russians. This closer, you know, easier to reach, and they may have targeted that first. They thought they'd be safer on the West Coast. That's very possible. Because the reasons that they gave for leaving, I never bought the reasons at all. They never were clear about it. They weren't honest about it. I bet you it had something to do with fear. Just like the Japanese bomb, you know, Pearl Harbor, World War II, there's a fear that Hawaii might be used as a first stage in bombing the United States with nuclear weapons. Just, you know, obliterate. It wouldn't obliterate the islands. Nuclear weapon. Well, the Tsar Bomba of the Russians might do a pretty good job of it. But I mean, yeah, if you drop a hydrogen bomb on the islands, it would probably, that'd be the end of the life on the island. You would think pretty much so. Yeah. I mean, the landmass would still be there, but probably no life forms on it. So it may very well may have scared them to leave Hawaii. And I much preferred Hawaii to the mainland, that's for sure. But that's a young person's perspective. You know, it's it may have, growing up, it may have seemed then, you know, too small. I feel island bound or something. Yes, possible. Yeah. We'll never know. We had civil defense drills, you know. Absolutely civil defense drills. Everybody was, you know, popular science magazines had, you know, bomb, how to build a bomb shelter, how to supply it, how to stock it, you know, ventilate, everything ventilated, how long do you have to stay underground for the radiation. I mean, we planned, we expected we would be hit by nuclear bombs, and how to survive it, you know, when can you come out from underground. So this will cause a young person to take refuge in dreaming, you know, there's no question about it. And I really did. It's almost like I've been in a cave my whole life, and you know, I'm trying to come out of the cave. You know, it's in the cave of dreaming. You feel safe when you're dreaming. You know, it's a way of detaching. In your dreams, you can go anywhere. You're not stuck in your house. You can dream you're anywhere. So, but ultimately, this whole universe is a dream. It's a dream of trying to escape guilt. Much worse than an atomic bomb is guilt, the belief in guilt, the belief that we annihilated God. And this is a lie. We didn't do anything to God. So we're dreaming of an escape from imaginary guilt. So the nuclear bomb thing is just a sort of a microcosm representing intense fear of this guilt. We're intensely frightened of guilt. But this feeling was really just that we felt, oh, it's impossible, we can't change God. Instead of accepting this, we said, no, it's guilt, we did it, we're guilty of doing it, we did it, We feel horrible. The aftermath of doing this is horrible. We feel like murderers. We feel something terrible. We did something terrible. We have to now get rid of this guilt. We must flee this guilt. So we fled this, trying to flee this guilt into dreams, into dreaming, into dreams of, and it follows us there. So we then try to dream of death and sickness and suffering and atonement and impermanence. It's all a dream. It's all, we took refuge in a big dream. I was driving Friday, and for me, some of the dreams I've had about asteroids, especially the ones that was so important, the world getting hit by an asteroid, it was symbolized by a pizza. And I recognize that if you look at a pizza, it's the surface, it's all the cheese, the pepperoni. If you just like did a contrast ratio of brightness and contrast, take all the color out of it and do all that, and you look at the surface of a pizza like that, what does it look like? It looks like an asteroid, is what it looks like. All pockmarked, you know, and depths and the way it looks. The surface of a space rock. It looks like a space rock. When we get pictures of asteroids, even pictures of the moon, other planets, they're hit by so many, you know, asteroids. They look like the big area there. It looks like a slice of pepperoni had been there or something, and here and there. It's like, it looks like a pizza pie. So. To me, it's pizza symbolizes space rock. So I'm driving along Friday, and I look. I'm praying to the Holy Spirit, help, Holy Spirit, what's going on? Clarify, please. I look to the side of me. And there's this truck, delivery truck, and it's a pizza delivery truck. And it had this big picture of a pizza on. I said, "Oh my God." An asteroid. What's going on? And then the message in script on the truck right there was, it's closer than you think. It is closer than you think. Now, they were trying to say that this pizza is closer, you know, it's an advertising slogan. But if you use the pizza to symbolize an asteroid, it means it's closer than you think. I said, oh my gosh. The Bible tells us that the situations will come about like a thief in the night. You have absolutely no time to, you know, do anything about it. It's just suddenly, without warning, like a thief coming in the night. Never see it coming. This is how the troubles will be. So what, you know, what could give worldwide trouble like that? You know, I pole shift could do it, or tilt of the axis of the earth. A big asteroid could do it. I don't know what else could do it. Super volcano could do it. Like Yellowstone. But, you know, earthquake, you know, it wouldn't throw a tsunami up on the coastline, but just like Japan, but it doesn't devastate the whole world. You know, what could devastate the entire world? You know, a really huge asteroid would do that, could do that, and a tilt of the Earth's axis could do that. But that wouldn't. Yeah, I could do that. And if the Earth stops spinning, you know, they have various scenarios that could throw the oceans out of their basin, you know, and create a total global catastrophe. And so there's various. You know, there's a few things that could do it. But an asteroid certainly is the most likely candidate. The sun going, you know, putting off just extremely high amounts of high energy particles could do it. Oh, anyway, so there's a lot of stuff. There's a lot of modifications of the dream that could, you know, there's ways to modify the dream in ways we don't realize that are really extreme modifications. We're told that Jesus tells us that whatever it can be changed was never real in the first place. It was a dream. Well, we have a dream of change, and we can, you know, set that down. Set dreaming down. No more need to dream. I don't want to dream anymore. I just say, I don't want to dream anymore. That's all. I just don't want to dream anymore. How different would life would have been if I just had trusted in that my precognition just realized, no, there isn't going to be any attack. The Russians are not going to attack. It's not going to happen. And then I don't have to worry about it at all. And even beyond that, just while I'm spirit, what am I? I don't have to be worried about anything. Nothing can touch me. Spirit could even pull the body back into another dimension if something like that happened easily. Could just cause the body to become temporarily light body, and then it could shift back to body of flesh again. You could do that. The spirit can do all that kind of stuff. So we have to. We have to allow all this, but hear all this. There will be more and more buildup as we go forward, as things. But this thing, it's closer than you think. It's closer than you think. Well, if it's in September of this year, that's only 2.5 months away. What's today? The 11th? 23rd? That's 12. 2 months, 12 days, it's like 9 to 10 weeks away, you could say, 9 to 10 weeks away. That's pretty doggone close. So, it seems like we're kind of entering like this end times feeling of drasticness, where it's harder and harder to brush aside the world. You know, just think, oh, we live in this ideal place and everything's going to be fine. We can just keep on dreaming the way we've been dreaming. It may be, you know, we may be put under great pressure to, you know, let go of our dreaming. Because the dreaming, we just say, wow, this is just too scary. I don't want to dream anymore. Just like that, I don't want to dream anymore. That's this morning I just said, I don't want to dream anymore. Plain and simple, I don't want to dream anymore. I've had it with dreaming. I'm finished with dreaming. I don't want to dream anymore. It's the end of dreaming. So just that's my feelings. Well, if I can back away from the world, the politics of the world, everything, all the news, you know, why can't I back away from dreaming? Which is just as kind of a news. It's like a world. It's really a world of its own, isn't it? Dreaming. A dream world. Why not just back away from that and say, I'm not going to pay any more attention to it. It's finished. I'm not going to even click. I mean, if you don't click on Google News or whatever news, you click Drudge or Report or whatever. If you don't, you know, or read the paper, radio, whatever. You don't know what's going on. You just don't click. Like if this world was a radio station, radio, just don't turn on the radio, and then you don't hear anything that's going on. Just don't turn on the radio. So maybe I'll just stop turning on the dream radio. Just won't turn it on anymore. And people say, well, you don't know what's going on in the world. I say, yeah, but I do know what's going on in my mind, which is stillness. Empty mind, non-dual abidance. I do know what's going on with that. That's much preferable. What about people that were born and pulled into World War II, you know, and had to fight in World War II, like my dad, you know, just entered I think freshman year of college, war broke out. That very day, you know, went down and enlisted. Everybody did, and that's it. And then instead of life on UCLA campus, it was basic training in Bismarck, North Dakota. And then rush to the Pacific War. Flying cargo planes, island hopping, and just like that, just out of freshman year of college. And then went through the hell of World War II, seeing all sorts of hell. And then coming back and saying, great, finally the war's over. Let's live in our little peaceful suburb here and forget about it. And then the doggone Cold War suddenly arises and we're having air raid drills and Soviets are ready to drop nuclear bombs on us. I mean, that couldn't have been very much fun for them either. That's like a double whammy. Which is why many of them, you know, didn't live that long. You know, let's eat steak and drink booze and smoke cigarettes and have a heart attack at 60 or whatever. Let's get out of here, basically. Was it the Mad Men generation? I mean, yeah, let's... it's very interesting that Social Security and all our, you know, these, a lot of these social programs were started back a ways where people didn't live nearly as long. I mean, men were expected to die in their 60s, or for sure 70s, a heart attack. I mean, the way they eat, the diet that they ate is ridiculous. And smoking and boozing and chomping down steak and just, you know, and high cholesterol cream and you name it. I mean, that they didn't live long. And so we have a society now that longevity has gone way up, and we expect living into our 90s. And so the social programs are not designed for that. We're never designed to cope with a population that lives into their 90s. It just doesn't happen. You know, it just is not going to work. So it won't work. That's a huge problem. You know, talk about problems going forward. Social Security and all this stuff, trying to subsidize us, everyone living into their 90s is just outrageous, because the longer you live, the more medical procedures you have, and people are starting to, you know, have medical procedures now. I talked to a doctor and he says people in their 30s now are starting to have all sorts of medical procedures. You add that up until they're 90, you know, and replacement hip, replacement knee, replacement shoulder now. You know, replacement this. They just, whatever, something wears out, they just replace it. Super expensive surgeries. You know, just throwing stents into arteries and just keeping you going. Bionic people. And yet, you know, they're not able to work past a certain age. And then they need all these benefits and medical insurance and paying all the incredibly expensive procedures they have. You know, this is just not very sustainable with the way that we're going about it. So, I know all the men, my dad's generation, got to get health and you get life insurance because you know you're going to kick off, you know, before your wife and leave a wife and family. It's very likely you will. A few of good constitutions don't, but the hard, I mean, someone just talked about in baseball how when they were playing baseball not too long ago, I mean, let's say 30 years ago or so, they say you walk into a clubhouse for your first day, you get traded to a new team or something. The first thing the clubhouse manager asks you would be, what brand do you smoke? That's the first thing they ask you, what brand do you smoke? Everybody smoked. It doesn't matter what brand. And drank tons of caffeine. So you have caffeine, smoking, boozing. I mean, they drank the hard stuff. You know, it's martinis, cocktail hour at work. They didn't, you know, their work breaks was cocktail hour. I mean, at the end of the day, whatever it was, okay, it's cocktail hour, and they go in there and start and boozing it up every day like that. This is business, smoking, boozing, and then go home and eat a, you know, sirloin steak with mashed potatoes and butter and sour cream, and then have some more booze, and then an after dinner smoke. Go to bed, get up, drink a jug of coffee, off, and, you know, fight in your job, super high stress, battle, and do it again every day, you know, and die when you're 50 something, you know. This is just the way it was. I mean, the women right now live 7 years longer, at least on the average, 7+ years longer than the average of men. 7 years longer. That's just astonishing. So, of course, they end up with the money and decide how to disperse it, you know, and live off of that, it's very, very common. Very, very common. The man had life insurance, you know, house, salary, everything, dies, wife gets it, sometimes they remarry. I mean, there are women that, like, four of their husbands have died, and they've gotten life insurance and their assets from all four of them, that kind of thing. They're filthy rich, and they're just, you know, cruising around the world all the time, whatever, they just... This is the world. Of course, they go after the ones they think are going to die, the hard living ones. They like, you know, they always wonder why are women so attracted to the real wild men, the hard, you know, the mad men. Why? Because they know they're going to die early. That's why. Isn't that amazing? You know, it seems very cynical, but it's very true. Women are extremely pragmatic in a lot of ways, and they say, hey, you know, he's gonna die when he's, you know, maybe late 40s, early 50s, get the life insurance, you know, all the savings, all the investments, the house, everything, then I'll marry again, find another one who's got 10 years left, find another madman, and maybe he'll die when he's 60, then I get that too, and then maybe one more marriage. This guy dies when he's 70. You see? So that's very common. Very common. So this is the secret. What do women want? Well, they want a guy who dies early. Actually, a lot of them. Makes a lot of money. You know, these hard-driving madmen, they can make a lot of money. Cause, you know, they're just wild and crazy and work like crazy and take risks and, you know, just... Push, go. And I say, yeah, it's great. I have, you know, got everything I want now, and then kicks the bucket, and then I get, you know, a lot more. I don't know, you know, $500,000, $1 million life insurance or something, and on and on and on. So what, you know, what they really want is, so if you're not that way, you think women aren't interested, not interested, so, well, he's not going to die. Why should I be interested in him? maybe I'll never die, you know. No interest. He's going to outlive me, you know. I don't want him to outlive me. That's terrible. What are you talking about? Just turn into a light body. I don't have any insurance. So why should I get insurance? I'm not going to die. Amazing world, if you really look at it in an unbiased, objective manner. You know, you often, people in the legal system see it much more clearly than we do. I've talked to some, heard reports from some, you know, who really work in the guts of the situation. Wow, there you see how nasty it is. those people tend to be way more objective. You know, sometimes, you know, policemen, law enforcement people, they see, you know, what really goes on, and they're much more pragmatic and objective. They're not so idealistic, actually. People have seen that what's really going on in the world, they're not so idealistic. They tend to be much more conservative. And they say, hey, you know, it's not, things are not so nice as we pretend them to be. Conservative means you're not going to jump into some idealism thinking, you know, wow, what a great world this is, how awesome everything is. It's just, if we just support this person or such and such, this is going to make everything great. No, they say, look, no matter what we do, it's not going to make anything great. But, and then the further conservative is that you realize, wow, no matter what road you take in this world, it all ends in death. You know, no matter what, there's no difference at all between the roads in this world. And so this makes you like super conservative. Like, why try to be doing all this social experimenting and changing rules, trying this. There's no reason to try any of that stuff. Let's just, don't waste our time. Let's just let it be the same that it's, don't try to change anything, because it's not going to work. It's just a waste of time. They're not saying that what they have is perfect. That too ends in death. But at least they're not the folly of trying to choose a different pathway where you know that too will end in death, despair, disappointment. Some pathways start out all full of fun and frivolity, think this is great, but they all end the same. So then knowing that, then you become spiritual. You can become spiritual. That's why a lot of conservative people tend to be very spiritual, religious, spiritual. They say, "Hey, this world doesn't hold what I want. I can never get what I want from this world. It's impossible." So they turn to being somewhat otherworldly. Religious people, they tend to be quite conservative, or I say conservative people tend to be quite religious, and you say, I can't find it here, I just can't find it here. Well, keep in mind that this world is a dream, so you can take refuge in the dream of no dream, in the condition-free condition. So even while you may still appear here, and still appear to have a body, there's no dreaming going on in the mind, so that is possible. You're not taking a pathway, when you stop dreaming, you're not taking some pathway in a dream. See, this is it's the one option we have. In the dream, all pathways lead to death. It's a dream of death. It's a dream of trying to atone for imaginary guilt. So it doesn't matter how they start out. If they end the same, then you stop being so adventurous. You say, to heck with it. Stop supporting all these social change, social programs, doing this, doing that. Hope. You know, there's no hope in any of it. Been around the block many times. You know what the situation really is. You know the conniving nature of existence. It's just like people, you know, older people, they realize, like, you know, men might look at women and realize, hey, you know, they're not going to solve my problem, no way. And women might look at men the same way and say, you know, romance, that's ridiculous. What a joke, what a lie, what a deception that all is. It's all a deception. It most certainly is. So the romance is gone. You know, the bloom's off the rose, and you realize, no, there's nothing there. There's nothing there that's going to change the outcome at all in this world. Just a mirage, ridiculous mirage. So then again, you turn toward religion. Absolutely, and religion does have an answer. Dream the final dream, which is a dream free dream, a dream of no dream, a dream of no dream, the conditioned free condition. That we can do, that we can do. Now, how does this help us be nice to other people and stuff? Well, in the condition, free condition, you realize that the dream has stopped, and you realize all this has just been a dream. It does not represent what we truly are at all. Not in a remote, even remotely. So you're then aware of what our true identity is. And so then you are able to then be so overjoyed of our true identity and relate to everyone, even though they keep identifying with this ridiculous dream symbol bodies, you're not fooled by it. So you may be expressing peace and joy to a body, but what you're not really expressing the body, you're expressing it to the spirit that is dreaming that they're this body. And you're basically saying, I know you're not this body. I'm not fooled in the slightest bit. The death of this body, the birth of this body has nothing to do with you. It doesn't affect you in the slightest bit. It doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. So we're told it's possible to get to this clarity by in the condition-free condition. The dream of no dream. Again, this whole dream is a dream of death. Why? We're trying to figure out a way to get free of this guilt. And this guilt is what? Imaginary. And why is it imaginary? Why do we do this? You see, this is where we go a little further than most in the teaching. Most say, well, there's some problem. We don't know how it came about, whatever, but you know, we can get free of it. But we know what the problem is here. It's this imaginary guilt that we believe is real. And why did we believe that where there was no guilt, there was guilt? Because we tried to change reality, wanted to be greater than God. We tried to have a bigger, stronger will than God. We tried to change reality. We couldn't. It was impossible. There was not even a moment where it was possible. And so we couldn't really entertain this idea of changing reality, because there's not even a moment where is possible. So we felt the impossibility of it immediately, and instead of saying, oh, it's impossible, okay, accepting this, we said, no, it's not impossible. I did it, but I'm feeling this terrible feeling now, and we call it guilt. I did it. I feel like, wow, I'm hurt by this something here. Something's hurting me, this guilt. And then we think the guilt is real, and then we then try to figure out, I gotta get rid of this. How do I get rid of this? And this is when we dream the dream of impermanence and death, and believing that all this, what's happening in the universe, is somehow freeing us ultimately from the guilt. And it's not, because there isn't any guilt. How can we get free of what doesn't exist? How can we say we're making progress towards getting rid of what doesn't exist? How can we measure that? How measurable it is? It's not measurable. It is not measurable. And that's part of the full stop and the wow, is because what we're letting go of, you know, it's not a measurable situation. Reality is not measurable, and the notion of getting free of what doesn't exist isn't measurable. There's nothing to measure. So we must full stop in the wow of just don't take any measure. Just sit and say, I'm not going to measure anything here. I'm not going to try and take any measurement here. Wow. Trying to get rid of what doesn't exist. How do you measure success there? Cannot. It's not measurable. There isn't any success. There's not even any failure. There's neither failure nor success. As long as we're thinking in terms of failure and success, we believe that the guilt is real. There's something to get rid of. There's nothing to get rid of. So there can't be either failure or success. There can't be either progress or lack of progress. So there can't be something, you know, we're doing good or we're doing bad. There can't be any of that. That's all a dualistic dream. It's like trying to get rid of zero by multiplying it by all these numbers and adding, subtracting, and thinking that, you know, what, but at every single instant, this right now, what is the situation? It's zero. This is. I am now. So there's zero guilt right now. The situation is always zero with us. Always. It's always been zero. Our attention has been on all the calculations and measurements and judgments. How are we doing? How much progress are we making? How can we go faster? What more can we do? But every instant we can say, no, I know the answer right now. It's zero. Anything times zero, whatever calculation you want to apply to zero, is always still zero. Whatever measurement you try to take, it's still zero. So we can always say, this is I am now. This is I am now. Meaning zero modification of I am, actually. We didn't modify reality. There's zero modification of reality. And zero guilt, therefore, over any. If you have zero modification, we also have zero guilt. And we can know that right now. It's always going to be that way. If we would delay a trillion years, it'll still be exactly the same as it is right now. Zero. Zero modification, zero guilt. Zero need to atone for non-existent guilt. Zero need for a dream of death. All zero, 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 zero. We can say there's a condition of zero, but ultimately we realize it's not even that. Zero condition is ultimately just a symbol, right? But we can abide in that for a while until we're ready to let that go. People, if you're in the depths of the ocean, people say, "Well, how is it on the surface?" I say, "Well, I don't need to know. The surface can never penetrate here. It can never be disturbed, so it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what calculation." It's kind of saying, "Well, what kind of calculations are going on?" I say, "It doesn't matter. It's still zero. Zero is right now. This is I am now. Zero. Zero modification." That little cricket's still going. Well, it hasn't stopped. The timing, I mean, it just keeps going like clock. Like clockwork. Just amazing. Yeah, another bee came in here. Looks like. No, what is that? I don't know what that is. Interesting. Don't move. Try not to move. Stay still. Even if insects are buzzing around you, just stay still. When we really allow ourselves and make a commitment not to move, not to go anywhere, not to do anything, then we will allow great clarification to arise that is shocking. And so much so that temporarily we might kind of feel like kind of a little bit out of it if we're trying to, you know, do things. We just feel a little bit out of sync. But we say, we don't have to worry. I'm not going to do anything. Well, that's what it, I don't know what kind of insect that is. I've never seen anything like quite like that. It's just so commitment to no action. Be committed to no action, and then this will be greatly helpful. Ah. No, that's some kind of bug. I don't know what kind. There, just hit me. Okay, just stay calm. Maybe it's symbolizing all the bugginess of the world. You know, how at the surface there's all these bugs flying everywhere. Beneath the surface there isn't. What are people doing other than this? They're watching television, looking at magazines, talking on the phone, various stuff. Okay, well, they could just as easily be doing this. Everybody has an evening time, right? How do you use your evenings is the question. How does anyone use their evenings? So I can say, yes, I've stopped dreaming. I've stopped dreaming. Yes, I have stopped dreaming. I am no longer dreaming. There's an assertion. Yes, I already know. I'm no longer dreaming. I'm no longer dreaming. I don't have any dreams anymore. Dreams are modifications. In order to dream of modification, you have to dream of bodies, don't you? Or you know, something, form, process, form, time, space, process, and form, and modification. If you're not dreaming of any modification, it can just be emptiness. It can be clarity. It doesn't have to have form to it. And beyond our dreams is essence. So it's empty of dreams. That doesn't mean that it's empty of essence. Essence cannot be modified. Reality cannot be modified. So you might say the end of dreams is, doesn't leave, you know, on one hand it's the condition-free condition, but then beyond that condition-free condition is essence and freedom. So yes, dreams have ended. Yes, all my dreams have ended. All my dreams have ended. And this sounds like a shocking thing. Of course, we think we're told that our hopes and dreams are our life. That's what's important. You say, all my dreams have ended. We automatically think of depression. I'm so depressed. So, oh, you lost all your dreams. It must be terrible. No, it's my dreams that are terrible. We just keep thinking, well, you got to have good dreams instead of bad ones. But even the good ones are subject, vulnerable to the bad ones. You know, it's all vulnerability. It's this vulnerability that's terrible. Thinking that somehow this vulnerability has something to do with the dreamer. It doesn't. So when the end of dreams is realized, the dreamer has not been affected by the dreams at all. So there hasn't been any modification of reality. So there isn't any guilt. See? So we don't need to dream a dream of death. So how is that bad? How is ending dreams bad? It's great. How else can you realize that nothing's been modified? Then, and there's no such thing as guilt. So this is hitting pretty hard, getting some wow reactions overall to this video. I would imagine that the viewers would also, this is really digging into the guts of it, where, you know, to stop dreaming is very profound and central. Remember, dreaming is an attempt to escape guilt. The belief that we modified reality, and ultimately modification of reality really would mean destruction of it. And we're just saying we can't go back there. So we bring up this awful feeling of terror, of dread, of guilt. We don't dare go back there. Something really has happened. Guilt just means that annihilation has happened. This is the belief annihilation has happened. There's this feeling of what we term guilt. Something's completely wrong, terribly wrong. And therefore, you can't go back. And so we must, you know, flee away from that. And yet the feeling is so horrible, we also have to find a way, we think we have to find a way to get rid of that feeling. You see, if we can't go back, then we're stuck. You know, we have to have a new life, a new creation, but we don't want to feel this horrible guilt. So how do we get rid of it? Well, through sacrifice of all these, you know, bodies, forms, impermanence of everything. It's this continual sacrifice. Ordinarily, on a summer evening like this, we have many, many, many little creatures, but there's only just one cricket, and it's just, I mean, that's all there is. There's no frogs, I mean, at all, because there's no water. I don't know if the frogs will come back. I mean, it's been such a drought, you know. Normally there's a chorus of hundreds of frogs, not a single frog. Just a lone cricket. But one lone cricket's better than none. Very reassuring. So maybe if there's just, you know, there's not that many of those who have the healed mind, you know, the dream-free mind. Maybe you know, it's enough to have a just like a one cricket here, one cricket there. I mean, it's a lot more reassuring than just no sound at all. We're just not used to the evening, no sound at all. So there's this one cricket. We say, oh, okay, there's something out there that's still, you know, still with it. The drought has not wiped this out. And it's amazing how helpful it can be just to take the edge off of darkness. Super helpful. It's like I am not alone. Me, it's me and the cricket. So we just keep doing this work, and the better we are get at this, then just these breakthroughs just emerge. They just emerge. So just keep your nose to the grindstone and keep practicing. This is the real secret of success. That's it. You know, full stop in the wow. It takes a while. That's why you need to give yourself time. The wow is very strong. This is very, you know, shocking type of information here. We've unearthed the root of it all. The root is unearthed. This is very shocking. Once we do that, it's like, wow, where do we go from here? If we seeing the root of it, well, you stop dreaming. Where else can you go, really? once having reached this, recognizing that, this just making up this idea of guilt to make it seem like that we really did modify reality, and then dreaming this dream of atonement for the guilt to try to get rid of it. Once we see that, that's all completely a lie, imaginary. There's no guilt at all. No modification at all. You know, that's reaching the bottom. You know, it's pulling it up by the roots. And then what do? Stop dreaming. What else is there to do? I can't modify myself, what I am. I can't hurt myself. I can't change myself. Therefore, there's no reason to dream a dream of atonement for the guilt of having done so. So I don't have to believe in bodies being hurt, or dying, or injured, or sick. I don't have to believe in any of that. Nothing bad has to happen. Nothing bad can happen to me. I don't even have to have a dream of something bad happening to me. Doesn't matter one way or the other, dream is just a dream, but I certainly have no reason to dream of something that is injurious or harmful, you know, or death or any of that stuff. There's no, doesn't serve any purpose at all. Might as well dream a happy dream. Dream a dream and no dream. But I cannot really figure out how that could be. The Holy Spirit has to just give that gift to us. I mean, Jesus says the Holy Spirit has that gift for us. I haven't received it yet. I don't understand how that could be possible. But I theoretically, you know, it just seems like it should be there somehow. I don't know. You know, you may be finished with dreaming. Others may not. They may want to. They still feel guilt is real, so they want their death. I mean, you can't just stop somebody's death. I mean, I don't see how that's possible. On the other hand, you might not have to see it. You know, you might just see them as perfect beings. And they may not see themselves that way, but it doesn't mean you have to see them the way that they see themselves at all. It doesn't mean that you have to do that. Something like that is definitely possible. They may see themselves as suffering pain and misery. So you may see them as like just a ball of perfect golden light that's not suffering at all. We don't have to see anything as suffering. Once we know the truth, there's no such thing as guilt. It didn't modify, it didn't change reality at all. Nothing to atone for. What do we need to see suffering and sickness and illness and death for? It's just all a dream anyway. Why do we have to see a dream in some particular format? We can change the format. We don't. It's a dream. Someone can see their self as sick, and you would see them as perfectly well. Now, which is true? Neither one is needed. But seeing it as perfectly well certainly attests to the truth that it's not needed. Because seeing that everyone's perfectly well means no one's atoning for any guilt, which would mean that the guilt doesn't exist, which means it's not real, which means we didn't modify reality. So seeing a dream of everyone, you know, perfectly happy and safe and unharmed and invulnerable and everything is a very powerful reminder that, you know, guilt is unreal, which means we didn't change what we are, which means reality is still perfect. And so that would be a helpful way of modifying the dream. How we doing here? How we doing here? Oh, about 2 hours worth. That's good. Nervous. This wow is very strong. I mean, we're talking about very, you know, we're doing like, you know, brain surgery here, or heart surgery or something. I mean, we're right into the heart of it. Some people might get upset. How dare you not see me as not having died? I need my death to be validated. I said, no, I'm not going to validate death for anybody. I'm not here to validate what is completely unnecessary based on a lie. I'm here to validate that you don't have to die. And indeed, what you truly are doesn't die at all. So I'm here to show you that you can dream a happy dream with no death. Okay. So, but some people might not like this. How dare? I mean, I died. I went to all this effort to die, you know, and I want my death to be meaningful. I don't see it having died at all. It's just like, you know, you're stepping in from one room to another. I said, you're still perfectly visible, perfectly aware, you know, the light body hasn't changed at all. So, I guess, you know, I just have to hang in there, and every day seems like go really big. And like I said, there's one cricket out there chirping, just one, but that one cricket out there chirping is sure making a huge difference. It just provides ambience, atmospheric ambience to the whole, you know, it's pitch dark out there, but still, I mean, it makes me feel like I'm not alone. There's ambience, there's life. So anything we can do to be of help, even if it just seems to be small, like that little cricket, can actually be very, very helpful. Maybe this video is like just that little cricket. Actually, this cricket is being immortalized on the video. I don't know if you're picking it up through this microphone. But indeed, that cricket is going viral worldwide here. Okay, so we hit the 2-minute mark. That's pretty good. And, yeah, time to wrap things up. Good, strong effort here. Good, strong effort. A lot of wow. I'm nervous. There's no question. We're into the very heart of it right now. And I'm not sure what will happen next, what will arise next. But I just say, okay. Yes, I've already stopped dreaming, so this is what it is. I've stopped dreaming. Okay. Not going to try to fit it somewhere. It's just, I stopped dreaming, and that's it. That's what's going on. Full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow.